This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
The head of Iran's Atomic Energy Organization described the performance of Yukiya Amano, the new director general of the International Atomic Energy Agency, as dishonest. This was the harshest criticism directed at the new chief of the IAEA since he took office. Amano said that they could not confirm that all nuclear material in Iran is intended for peaceful activities.
This comes amidst the West's relentless efforts to impose sanctions on Iran. A U.S. delegation arrived in Beijing to discuss the matter with Chinese officials. Meanwhile, the Russian president said that his country will not oppose what he referred to as smart sanctions.
I wonder how much Iranians miss this man. Egyptian Mohammad al-Baradei completed his work with the IAEA in Vienna and returned to his country. He left behind an issue that can still be potentially dangerous.
We cannot confirm that all nuclear material in Iran.
الملف النووي الإيراني انتقل تقنيا إلى يد الياباني يوكيا أمانو.
The Iranian nuclear issue has been automatically handed down to Japanese Yukiya Amano, who is now hosting the first conference for the IAEA Directors Committee to discuss the issue. Before the conference, he presented a stern position saying that he cannot confirm that all nuclear material in Iran is meant for peaceful activities, and that Tehran is not properly cooperating with UN inspectors. He released a resolution earlier hinting at the possibility of Iran being in a position to build nuclear warheads. Therefore, Amano hit Iran's position that its nuclear program is peaceful twice, a program that has caused worldwide controversy. The head of the Iranian Atomic Energy Organization, Ali Akhbar Salahi, described Amano as biased and his approach as abnormal. But Salahi said that he hopes that Amano would change his position and approach Iran, indicating that his country cares about maintaining a sound relationship with the IAEA. The Iranian foreign minister also confirmed that cooperation with the IAEA will continue. The IAEA has become the only reference for Iran's nuclear profile, as opposed to the UN Security Council, which is seen by Iran as an obedient tool of the United States. The IAEA does not seem to be obedient enough until now, but Western countries are trying to do everything they can to convince the members who are still hesitating on the resolution of the issue.
Unfortunately, we saw no progress in negotiations with Iran in the last phase. The situation is deteriorating. But despite everything, we are optimistic in our ability to reach an agreement. If we do not succeed, then Russia is ready, along with its partners, to seek sanctions that are thoroughly studied and smart and will not hurt the civilians.
President Medvedev talks about smart sanctions, and I say smart and efficient. Our positions are extremely close, which is very important.
China had reservations about discussing its position and reiterated that the diplomatic option was still open. This is a diplomatic expression that contains the hidden intention of opposing the sanctions. Washington initiated direct negotiations with China and sent two of its prominent diplomats, Deputy Secretary of State and Senior White House Asia Advisor, to Beijing. The U.S. Secretary of State said that the meetings will include Iran's nuclear issue, among others that caused tension in the relations between the two countries. China only stated that the Americans were the ones who requested the negotiations, which will include their bilateral relations.
زار هانيبال القذافي نجل الزعيم الليبي.
Hannibal Muammar Gaddafi, the Libyan leader's son, visited the Swiss businessman who had been detained in a Libyan prison since 2008 following a diplomatic row between the two countries. Meanwhile, hundreds of Libyan students held a demonstration outside the Swiss embassy in Tripoli to protest the Swiss ban on building minarets and to demand the boycott of Swiss products.
كانت لافتتهم عبارة عن صور الزعيم الليبي العقيد معمر القذافي.
They held posters of Libyan President Muammar al-Qaddafi and praised his call for jihad against Switzerland, which he described as an infidel and vulgar country.
تعود جذور توتر العلاقات بين البلدين إلى عام 2008.
Tensions between the two countries started in 2008 when Swiss authorities arrested Hannibal Muammar Gaddafi and his wife in Geneva over a complaint by two of their former housekeepers.
خادمتان كانتا تعملان لديهما.
Libya responded by withdrawing its deposits in Swiss banks and arrested two Swiss citizens in Tripoli. One of them was released, while the other will remain in prison until July 2010.
فيما يمضي الثاني عقوبة بالسجن تنتهي نهاية يونيو المقبل.
Libya denies any link between the detention of Hannibal Muammar Gaddafi in Switzerland and the arrest of the Swiss nationals in Libya. In fact, Libya wanted to prove this point by holding a meeting between Hannibal Muammar Gaddafi and the detained Swiss businessman Max Goldie at the Libyan prison.
بين هانيبال القذافي ورجل الأعمال السويسري ماكس غولدي.
During the meeting, Goldie said that he was happy with the visit of Hannibal Muammar Gaddafi. Hannibal also expressed solidarity with Goldie.
Hannibal expressed his sympathy towards Mr. Max Goldie and asked me personally to convey his feelings of solidarity. Hannibal wants me to help Goldie get out of his current situation by making use of all the available local agencies in Libya. He said that he has no issues with Mr. Max Goldie and that he's only seeking justice from the Swiss authorities.
The lawyer demanded that the Libyan judiciary system pardon his client, but this may depend on the response of the Swiss government to Hannibal Gaddafi's complaints. Hannibal also demanded compensation from a Swiss newspaper that published his photo while he was in detention, an unforgivable act in the eyes of Libyans. Rashid Al-Shafi Al-Alawi, BBC.
The Shabab Islamic movement that controls areas in the middle and south of Somalia warned the World Food Program against the distribution of aid in the country.
The security situation is unstable, and the lawlessness left behind from past civil wars and successive governments does not seem to be the worst problem facing Somalia today. In front of the specter of a famine that could affect close to half of the country's population of 4 million people, the armed Shabab Islamic movement that controls the biggest part of the center and southern part of the country warned the World Food Program, or WFP, in Somalia not to distribute aid. The group sees it as a facade to implement the political agenda of Western countries. The movement did not justify itself only by talks of political issues. It also accused the WFP of distributing expired goods and voiced alleged complaints by local farmers that the quantity of distributed aid prevents them from selling their products for fair prices. Targeting the WFP in Somalia is nothing new. In the beginning of the year, repeated threats forced the program to suspend its activities in the southern part of the country. In addition, every once in a while, pirates attack ships loaded with aid. The Shabab movement has imposed conditions on relief organizations working in the country, most importantly, preventing them from interfering in Muslim matters, making them expel their female employees, and requiring the payment of $20,000 in taxes every 6 months. The warning against aid distribution did not only apply to foreigners. The armed movement also issued a warning to Somalis contracted by the WFP to end their contracts immediately. Mohammed Bazaid Al-Arabiya.
The Director General of National Security in Morocco announced that it disbanded a terrorist cell composed of 6 individuals that was active in many Moroccan cities. It added that the detained were planning on executing terrorist activities in the country. Jordan's State Security Court issued prison terms for 6 Jordanians convicted of forming an armed group that tried to infiltrate the Gaza Strip to execute a military operation against Israel in 2009. Fugitive Mohammed Jamal Hamdan was sentenced to life in prison with hard labor. Osama Kabir, Sakr Zedan, and Hassan Khalela were sentenced to 15 years each after their life sentences were commuted.
The Palestinian cabinet moved its weekly meeting from Ramallah to Hebron today in a symbolic act of protest against Israeli national heritage lists. There have been daily confrontations with soldiers in Hebron since last week's cabinet decision. The Palestinian cabinet secretary said that the PA hopes that the world will help pressure Israel to reverse the decision. And meanwhile, inter-Palestinian factionalism continues. Hamas parliament speaker Aziz Duaik, who lives in Ramallah, today failed in his effort to hold joint meetings between parliament members in Gaza and Ramallah via video conference. The Palestinian Authority refused to permit Duaik to enter the parliament compound in Ramallah to hold the meeting, saying that the Hamas Legislative Council is not legal. Police today restricted access to the Temple Mount compound in Jerusalem's Old City. Access was limited to Muslim men aged 50 years and older in possession of blue identity cards in an effort to prevent a reoccurrence of yesterday's riots. 4 policemen and several Palestinians were injured on Sunday in disturbances that were called in protest of the cabinet's decision on the list of national heritage sites. Accusations of Israeli involvement in last month's assassination of top Hamas commander Mahmoud al-Mabhouh were today ratcheted up another notch. Dubai Chief of Police Dahi Khalfan today announced that he is absolutely certain that the entire hit team is currently hiding in Israel to escape arrest. Another development in the case is the announcement of an alleged 27th suspect, also believed to have been traveling on an unspecified European passport. And meanwhile, citing post-mortem results, Dubai police say that Mabhouh had been injected with a fast-acting sedative prior to having been suffocated. And the Emirati Al-Ittihad Daily today reported that a 3rd Palestinian has been detained for questioning. The only suspects under arrest on suspicion of involvement until now are 2 other Palestinian residents of Dubai who have been extradited from Jordan.
الحكومة الإسرائيلية تلتحق بالحكومة البريطانية على طريق التحقيق في استخدام جوازات سفرها.
The Australian government follows the actions of the British government by holding an investigation into the use of Australian passports in the assassination of Hamas leader Mahmoud al-Mabhouh in Dubai. Canberra demanded that the Israeli government and its intelligence agencies fully cooperate with the investigation. It will include the questioning of 3 Australian nationals whose passports were used by the individuals that participated in the assassination of Mabhouh. The Australian authorities gave Dubai the results of the investigation pertaining to how Australian SIM cards were used in the assassination of
Mabhouh. وفي القضية ذاتها سلمت النمسا السلطات في دبي نتائج التحقيق الذي قامت به حول استخدام شرائح.
Australian Interior Ministry spokesman Rudolf Golia revealed this information but refrained from issuing any further statements.
غوليا أعلن ذلك من دون الإدلاء بأي تفاصيل أخرى. وكانت معلومات سابقة قد تحدثت.
There is some information that the individuals who carried out the assassination used 11 Australian SIM cards.
10 شريحة لأرقام هواتف نقالة نمساوية. وفي مستجدات القضية أيضا قالت صحيفة The National الإماراتية إن دبي طالبت
According to the national newspaper in the UAE, Dubai demanded that the FBI investigate prepaid credit cards that were issued in the US and used by the suspects in the assassination of Mabhouh. An American official from the FBI told the national newspaper in the Emirates that the agency will investigate Israel's involvement in the assassination. The Dubai police also told the national newspaper that 13 of the 27 suspected assassins used prepaid MasterCards that were issued by the American MetaBank to purchase plane tickets and make hotel reservations.
وفيما أصاب على الاتهام تصوب إلى إسرائيل وجهاز استخباراتها الخارجي.
While accusations for the assassination of Mabhouh in Dubai are directed at Israel and its Mossad agency, occupation officials refrain from commenting on the matter. During an interview with Christiane Amanpour, Israeli Defense Minister Ehud Barak dodged all questions linking the Mossad to the assassination in Dubai.
بعلاقة الموساد بعملية الاغتيال.
Welcome back. Our guest, Ehud Barak, is no stranger to the secretive world of special operations. He's famous for foiling an airplane hijacking by disguising himself as a mechanic, and for once dressing up as a woman during an undercover mission to kill Palestinians. Now there's another secret operation in the news, the assassination of a top Hamas commander in Dubai, and many are blaming that on Israel. Israeli Defense Minister Ehud Barak joins me again. Is this another secret Mossad operation?
I have nothing to say about this event in Dubai.
Except,
I want to correct.
Well, let me go back to this issue here, because at first, when the reports came out in Israel, there was, you know, a certain amount of pride and glee. There were also words to the effect that Israel had this was the way to attack terrorism. And then things got a little bit dicey because all these pictures came out, all the surveillance video, all the passports and the faked identities and the stolen identities, governments calling your ambassadors in to ask what on earth is going on.
Christian, you know me long enough to assume that when I tell you that I have nothing to say about this story, I have nothing to say and I will not say.
Would you deny it?
I will not say anything.
Has been urged to live up to its commitments to the Palestinian people by an international tribunal being held in Spain. The Russian Tribunal on Palestine, which seeks to mobilize international opinion, says the EU is complicit in Israel's brutalization of the Palestinians. Roshan Mohamed Saleh, Press TV's correspondent, we have, and also we're going to turn to lawyer, and we have human rights lawyer James Phillips. Thank you so much for being with us. Well, go ahead, Roshan. Tell us the latest that you have on this.
Yes, thanks for that. We've just had a very interesting last session of this Russell Tribunal on Palestine. And we heard from a very eminent international psychiatrist who talked about the plight of Gaza and the economic blockade of Gaza on three sides by Israel and on one side by Egypt. Now with me I have James Phillips, who's an Irish barrister. Now James, you actually made an internet intervention yesterday.
Yes.
To this tribunal.
Yes.
Can you summarize that for the viewers?
Yes. Well, you've outlined it very well, what is actually going on in the chamber today and yesterday. My contribution as an Irish delegate and as an Irish barrister was to deal with the issue of the settlements, which the Israelis are in illegal occupation since 1967 in the entirety of the West Bank, and the plundering of the natural resources while they are there, such as water. And since 1967, after the preemptive strike which Israel launched in Egypt, immediately after that they took control of the West Bank, the entirety of Gaza, Sinai, and the Golan Heights. They have, of course, since returned Sinai to Egypt. They withdrew from Gaza in 2005 entirely to suit themselves, entirely to deal with what they had was a demographic problem. And in withdrawing from Gaza in June 2005 or August 2005, they effectively solved that demographic problem by approximately one-third. It wasn't, as the world was led to believe by Bush and Blair when they went on the television after the withdrawal from Gaza, it wasn't that the Israelis were doing a wonderful thing for the Palestinians. They were hailed on international television by Bush and Blair and to a certain extent the European community at how wonderful Israel was withdrawing from Gaza. And that was the image that was put out, which was essentially propaganda. And it was quickly asserted by the Israelis that now this was an opportunity and a chance for the Palestinians to demonstrate that they were capable and worthy of nationhood. But what in fact happened was they left entirely to suit themselves, and they left behind them an area which was not rich in agriculture, not rich in industry, and have in fact since effectively controlled Gaza by land, sea and air. And we saw a recent example of that last year when they went back into Gaza and perpetrated a slaughter of innocents, murdering hundreds of women and children in December 2008 and into early 2009. And still, the international community has not called Israel to account for that invasion of Gaza. So in terms of what has been done since 1967, they have occupied the West Bank in its entirety and have developed a whole system and network of settlement villages, settler roads linking those villages, which are high quality roads, top of the range asphalt, 4- and 5-lane roads, which are for use of settlers only. Palestinians are excluded from those roads. If they attempt to use them, they will be shot.
ملحق لخطابه الأول مفاجآت لإسرائيل يحتفظ بها الأمين العام لحزب الله السيد حسن نصرالله إلى حين
In the supplementary part of his speech, Hezbollah's Secretary General Sayed Hassan Nasrallah said that he is saving grand surprises for Israel and that he will announce them at the right time. What's important about these surprises is that they come after the three-way meeting that was held in Damascus between Ahmadinejad, Assad and the Hezbollah leadership. Nasrallah's remarks come in response to the latest U.S.-Israeli threats. Nasrallah said that his meeting with Ahmadinejad, Assad and the Palestinian factions in Damascus is sufficient enough to answer all the messages sent by the U.S. Nasrallah described news reports about the possibility of a split in relations between Iran and Syria on one side and Syria and the Lebanese resistance on the other as lies. After his meeting with the Syrians and the Iranians in Damascus, Nasrallah said that when we threaten Israel, we are aware of what we are saying. He added that they strongly stand behind each word, confirming that each one will be followed by action. Nasrallah reiterated that what was announced today was nothing but part of a surprise package to Israel. Nasrallah further said that during his consultation with leaders of the resistance, they briefed him on some of the facts in the region, stopping short of disclosing any pertinent details.
The Israelis are well aware that each word uttered would never be uttered unless we can turn it into action. What was announced was only part of it. It's not everything we have in mind. On the eve of the meeting in Damascus, we agreed to withhold some news for later as part of our surprise package to Israel. We need to save some surprises for other occasions. When I consulted with some of our brothers in the resistance, they introduced me to some of their ideas. If I disclosed everything on February 16th, then I won't have anything to talk about on June 25th or August 14th. We must save some of these surprises for later dates. We don't have to create a problem in the region on each occasion. No. The message was received hours before our meeting in Damascus. The message was delivered to Beirut as well as Damascus. We have received these messages from the Americans. The position taken by Damascus and Tehran shows that we are capable of countering these messages sent by the Americans, all of the messages. As you know, during the past few weeks, some Arab media outlets and journalists, as well as some news writers, talked about the possibility of strained relations between Iran and Syria on one side and Syria and the Lebanese resistance on the other. These are lies. They kept stating lie after lie to the point that they started to believe their own lies. These are baseless and out of reality, as the past few days have proven.
American law firm Rebec Law announced that it has filed a lawsuit against Boeing and Ethiopian Airlines on behalf of victims of the Ethiopian Airlines plane crash. This was announced on the eve of Prime Minister Saad al-Hariri's scheduled meeting with the families of the plane crash victims. How has the government been dealing with this disaster since it took place? Rabia Shalta has the report.
إنها الكارثة الأولى من نوعها التي يمنى بها لبنان منذ عقود عدة ومن أجل ذلك فإن تحطم الطائرة
This was the first major disaster of its kind to be witnessed in Lebanon in decades. For that reason, the Ethiopian airplane that crashed on January 25th and the tragedies endured by Lebanese and Ethiopian families as a result has put the country and all of its organizations in front of the reality of having to face a serious crisis. The only thing to do was to motivate all the relevant institutions inside the country to search for the victims. This effort was conducted with the help of foreign experts and technicians. It took a month to recover all the bodies of the Lebanese and Ethiopian victims, as well as the two black boxes. Two ships used by the government, Ocean Alert and Odyssey Explorer, had been working intensively to find debris from the wreck, which was retrieved by the Commandos Regiment of the Lebanese Army. Additional help in the search effort was conducted by Lebanon's boat Kana. All this effort reaffirms the importance of the international community's support, which is conducting an investigation into the incident. Various parliamentary sessions and a number of ministerial hearings reported on the latest developments in the search. The government refused to follow the internationally held practice that limits the search effort to 72 hours, and was determined to continue the search until all the bodies were recovered. The latest information obtained by Future TV showed that the search ended after all the bodies of the victims and the two black boxes were recovered. There is nothing left but the wreckage of the plane at the bottom of the sea. Following the recovery of all the bodies and their release to their parents for some comfort, the search ended and a meeting is scheduled to take place between Prime Minister Saad al-Hariri and the families of the victims. In the latest parliamentary session, Hariri said that this meeting will be a chance to turn words into action, and it will include Hariri's explanation of what happened to the families and inform them of the development of the case. He said that the meeting will steer clear of the approach used by some to incite the families against the government and its leader, and will reject special interests that are traded at the expense of the citizens.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic Video Podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.